Oh God, as we gather in your name again, we're grateful. We're mindful of so many things, the announcements and the conversations that we've already had and been a part of. We pray for those. We give thanks for successful procedures and surgeries. We pray for those that are either facing treatments or surgeries or in the middle of those who've lost loved ones, those who are traveling. And throughout this week and times of rest and Sabbath and break, we're grateful for those opportunities. And so everything that makes us who we are and everything that's a part of our life, we want to give thanks and also bring that before you as an act of faith and prayer for our upcoming Missions Day and in our community. What we want to do is a couple things. We want, oh God, that we want to just through service lift up your name. And what we hope is that people who either are well versed in your love and mercy, or those who are on the fringes, or even those who have yet to see any aspect of that. We want to pray that through an act of service, a day of service that we call St. Paul for All, that somehow people catch a glimpse of your love for all people. And so use us, oh God, we pray, and use that time of service as a way to help us mature in our faith, just as study is a part of that as well. So we give you this time, we give you our minds and our hearts today, and we pray this in the name of Christ. Amen. Okay, so we're in John. We've been looking at John chapter 9, and I think we're, even though we really didn't get to the very end of the chapter, we've sort of danced around it enough to know that what's going on. I mean, basically, Jesus is walking in to the city with his disciples. They are confronted with a man who was born blind. Jesus heals the man. And so you get a number of things going on. After he heals the man, there's two real events that are taking place. One, there is the side of it that has to deal with the leaders of the religious leaders of the community, and their interactions with Jesus because the man was healed on the Sabbath. And so there's a little bit of conflict there. And yet at the same time, we got the person that was healed, and you get to see what's going on inside of his faith development. And there are four titles, or at least four levels of change or growth inside or of maturation inside of the person. You know, at first, he sees Jesus as just a man, and then, you know, Jesus is a prophet. And then you've got Jesus as, like a teacher, a rabbi, a religious teacher. And then at the very end, you got him as Lord. And so you see inside of chapter 9, this, what I call faith progression. And the reason why I like chapter 9 is because I think that's more in line for how people process their faith and how they grow and mature in their faith. Now, there might be... I've got it, Donna. Don't worry about it. Our preschoolers are happy. You have this growth inside of the person that is... You know, from their interactions of Jesus... And I think that's how it works for us. I mean, obviously you enter into the kingdom, but in that whole initiation process, there's levels of growth. And faith is designed for that. Faith is not designed to be stagnant, to be just, you know, I did it way back then, or I joined the church, or I was baptized, or you know, that's a part of it. But there's a... Faith is to be fluid. Faith is to be dynamic. Faith is to grow. And so we see that here inside of this person, which which I think puts chapter 9 as one of the, you know, definitely the asterisk chapters inside of the whole gospel. Because you see this man that's healed, and then he grows, and it ends with he's on his knees in front of Jesus, which in the Gospels is that's a disposition of belief. So it's really a fantastic chapter. Anything that we need to kind of recap, or since we've last met, which I think has been a couple of weeks, you've just stayed up every night just waiting. And we don't want you to wait anymore. So if there are any questions about 9, we'll answer. If not, we'll go ahead and jump into chapter 10. All right. Well, into 10, onward and upward, right? So if someone would read for us in chapter 10, verses 1 through 6. All right. All right, thank you. Inside of chapter 10, what we're going to discover is that Jesus is going to be compared to a couple of different images. One is going to be this idea of Jesus being compared to thieves and robbers. You're going to have Jesus being compared to what's a good shepherd and what is not. So at least in the first 21 verses, you get this compare and contrast of who Jesus is, what Jesus does, compared to things in the ancient world. And, we leave chapter 9, and you've got how people have treated this blind man. And by the religious leaders, he's treated very poorly. Obviously, by Jesus, he's treated completely different. And so that sets the stage for us in chapter 10, is this caring shepherd who watches over the sheep as compared to others. And obviously, the concept of caring for sheep, shepherd, very prominent inside of Old Testament and New Testament, particularly in their societies, not so much today. But this would be these analogies that Jesus is using. I mean, they would all have just picked up just like that. So when we look at this very first part of the chapter, you've got this image of how do you care, of a certain way of caring for sheep, particularly around the idea of, a shepherd compared to a thief and a robber. And then you've got this idea of a gatekeeper. It's not like what we have where you have your house and you got your backyard or your side yard or your front yard and you put a fence around it and you put all your stuff in there. A little bit different in the ancient world. The homes were sort of stuck on top of each other. And at the same time, there were gates or at least areas of containment for sheep. And many of the you might have a community worth of sheep, and Sue's got her sheep mixing in with Jean's sheep, mixing in with Betty's sheep, and that would be okay because they would recognize, when you called your sheep, they would get up and leave. When you called yours, they would get up and leave. So it's, almost like the way we would, you ever go to dog trials? I don't know if you ever do that or not. I didn't think so. I was taking a stab at it, But when you go to dog trials, all these dogs are together and whatnot, and when the owner or the trainer of the dog whistles, calls, or whatever they've used to train their dog, their dog leaves the group and goes and pays attention to its own trainer, to its own master or owner. Somewhat, yeah. I mean, my brother used to do this, and it's impressive. Same with the sheep, and some of it was safety in numbers, and if you've got one or two shepherds that are watching just their sheep compared to 10, it works out with sleep and food and whatnot. So there was a practical application to them all being together. But Jesus is using what they know about, at least about this level of profession and this level of their society, to make analogies about who he is compared to other folks. So in this chapter, we obviously see this image of the idea of a shepherd, Jesus being a shepherd. That's back in the Old Testament. The image of that imagery of God as a shepherd is well versed. I mean, what would be some examples in the Old Testament of God's activity with humanity as being described as a shepherd? Psalm 23, exactly right. You got Psalm 23, Psalm 28, Psalm 80, Isaiah 40. The comfort ye my people, part of Handel's Messiah. Well, part of, is that a male or female? That's a male, yeah. Tenor, first tenor, right, yeah. Part of that is they get into around, I think it's verse 20, and it talks about God's role as a shepherding of his people. And so Jeremiah 31, Numbers 27, 2 Samuel 5, I mean Jeremiah 10, 12, Ezekiel 34, all of those are just examples of God care, God being described through the image of a shepherd. And so this is well versed inside of these people, and Jesus is making comparison to himself being that he is the shepherd, which is compared to what, or contrasted to what in the text? To a thief and a robber. And, now, who is Jesus talking about, thief and robber? Is he talking about anybody specifically?
He's always talking about the Pharisees.
Well, I mean... The answer is we don't know. I mean, we don't know if this is if this is just a general comparison to a thief or a robber. A thief would be someone who sneaks in. A robber would probably come with force. And but he's not referring to like Satan or anything like that. Or we just don't know. There are other examples in the New Testament that thief is used or robber is used in connection with Satan. It's hard to make John 10 be an example of that. It sounds more like in the passage that he's just making a general comparison between someone who's good, a good shepherd, compared to someone who is a thief or a robber. But what they do is they enter the fold inappropriately, either crawling over a wall, or coming through the door where there would be a watchman or a watchperson there. The sheep, I mean, even though they didn't have like a backyard, there was some level of a structure that they would put the sheep in when they're not out grazing. And normally it had a gate, and not a gate like what we have, but someone would sleep here and stay there, and they're the watchman. And, when all the other sheep, they're in here doing whatever they're doing, this one made sure they didn't get out, and also protected others from coming in. Because in a moment, Jesus also is going to make a comparison to not just that Jesus is the good shepherd, but he's also going to make a comparison that Jesus is the gate. So there's a couple of different things going on where Jesus is using this whole concept of shepherd, sheep, gate, door, and he's using those elements similar to a parable to teach them or to introduce them into the person that Jesus is. So you got him as a good shepherd. You got him as a, you know, maybe a good watchman or a good door. And so that's what's going on in this first little bit. And again, all this comes just after what took place in chapter 9. In chapter 9, you've got this one who is not cared for. I mean, if he was a sheep, would be out, and who knows where, and been discarded, but yet Jesus is caring for. So he's teaching from the experience that they just had, if that makes sense. And as we would imagine, the people around him don't catch the meaning. So let's keep going. Are any comments or questions about that? Do you see some of the things that are going on, or do you have any questions or thoughts around verses 1-6? Verse 6, this figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So there, to some degree, there's a struggle on them making the connection that Jesus is the good shepherd and Jesus is the watchman or the good watchman, or the door or what have you. We all good? All right. So if someone read verse 7, we're going to go be ambitious here. 7-21. All right.
Therefore Jesus said again, I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who ever came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. He will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd who owns the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he's a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must also bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. At these words, the Jews were again divided. Many of them said, he is demon-possessed and raving mad. Why listen to him? But others said, these are not the sayings of a man possessed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?
All right, thank you. So we've got a couple things going on here. Again, this is a... This interaction that he's interacting with the crowd, trying to explain certain things about who he is by using these analogies. So you've got these thieves and robbers, you've got the Old Testament shepherds, and that we're not, when we say Old Testament shepherds, we don't mean the shepherds who lived in the same day as Abraham or the same day as Moses. Think about the people in the Old Testament that were often thought of as the shepherd of the people during their time. Who would they be? Moses. Yeah, Moses. You got Moses. You got what? Abraham.
David.
Samuel. I mean, you got all these different, all these heroes in the Old Testament. And for the first century folks in our text, they would be imagining these types of people. And so when Jesus is setting himself apart compared to, to the thieves and the robbers, what he's not doing is saying all these people in the past you know, they're thieves or they're robbers as much as he's. I mean, he's not interested in a chronological comparison as much as it is those who are in competition with him during his day. I mean, there are other folks who, if you go back and look at some other writings, I mean, even inside of a lot of the zealots, and the zealots believed that if we could force God's hand, then God would reveal the Messiah, which then would change the, you know, it would put the Romans on the bottom and Israel on the top. And there are people who would, and they thought the way, you know, they're waiting on God to act, waiting on the Messiah, you know, it's not here. And so they said, well, God just needs, you know, we got to prime the pump, jumpstart God. And so, they, you know, God's not going to forsake his people. So if we attack the Romans and forced a war, then God would have to reveal, even if it's premature. And so there were many zealots at this time, even before Jesus, and some even after Jesus, that would go around saying, I'm the Messiah, let's attack, and you'll see. And Jesus is comparing himself not to the heroes in the Old Testament, that's my terms, as much as he is to those who are seeking to steal from his flock in present day, as in present day Jesus, in forms of competition. And again, go back to what we talked about just a little bit earlier, where you've got all these sheep would be, you know, the way it would work is they would all intermingle, and then the ones who knew the master, when the master whistled or called or whatever, those sheep would then come out because they would not follow another voice, if that makes sense, even though they're people trying to come in through the gate and steal or to rob. Does this make sense? I mean, so it's a theological comparison to what Jesus is doing in this text. And he's using images that that they're very familiar with. In this passage, he does talk about the door and the gate. This is not to mean that Jesus should walk through himself. You know, it's not a literal translation as much as it's to, he's given this figurative language to help them understand who he is as the Messiah. And in the passage that Betty read for us, there's two major themes. One is the theme of protection, and then one is the theme of nurture. Going in through the gate, you know, just imagine the structure looks like this. Going in through the gate, being inside the gate, and the person here is blocking the entrance so that only those, you know, it's not going to let any outside forces get in to harm the sheep, then the gate is the place of protection. And so he's making, when he calls himself a gate, that's what he's talking about. And then at the same time, going out through the gate, you know, there's an idea of going out through the gate. The sheep can find water, they can graze, you know, they can find what is needed for life. If they just stayed inside of this area of protection, it wouldn't be long before they died. So, again, Jesus is just using something common that to help explain who he is. Now, this brings up an interesting point for us that's really not a part of the text, but it's definitely worth considering. When, not if, right? When you share your faith, right? When, not if. When you share your faith, you can see what Jesus is doing. He's taking something that's common to all of them. They all know about sheep. They all know about shepherds. They all know about gates. They all know about protection and nurture and whatnot. And he uses what is common to then help explain something that is, or maybe uses something that's physical or temporal to explain something that is spiritual. And often when we think about, gosh, I don't know what to say, Well, you can start with what's common to us all. If you were in church on Sunday, the passage that we looked at with and looking at some of the last sayings of Jesus, the idea of thirst. Jesus on the cross, one of the things that he says before he dies is, "I'm thirsty," or "I thirst." We all have thirst. And so you can, there's not anybody in here that doesn't get thirsty, right? Some of y'all are getting thirsty here in about 10 minutes, right? So that's all right. Yeah, shake it. Yeah, ready to go. It could be others. In the Old Testament, the concept of storms. If you ever read the book of Isaiah, Isaiah loves to talk about storms and how there's one who walks through the storm, one who can calm the storm. What are some of these other not so much the Bible, but inside of our life today, what would be some common elements to us all that would be easy? It's an easy way then to make transition and to talk about something that's bigger than just the element itself.
Worry.
Yeah, worry. So. Well, Sandy, I hate to tell you, you're the only one here. So that's really not common to us. But the idea of, concern for family, concern for friends, that is common. And that'll show up in any time period. And that'll show up in any part of the world. So it's not just a Columbus thing or a St. Paul thing or an American thing. This is something that's common to, wherever you go. That asked me about my grandchildren, that works in any language, okay? So, for instance, if you are talking to someone you don't know, or you're talking to someone that you do know, and you feel prompted to share your faith, one of the ways you might start is, let me tell you what helps me with this, all right? So, that could be an avenue in. What's another? Illness, yeah, absolutely. Illness. One of my just kind of preacher mentors, I heard him say one time, just give it 5 more minutes and then it'll happen. He said it's going to happen to us all, at some point, just wait. Or what he said, when he turned 65, he went and he was having his physical. And he told that he was complaining to the doctor about all the things he felt now when he woke up. And the doctor didn't give him, he was wanting the doctor to say, don't worry or whatever. And the doctor said, well, if you ever wake up and you don't feel it, you probably have had a stroke, so call me quick. I've never forgotten those two things. Have illness. So, we all will experience that. No one is spared that in life. And so that's then another common way. And this is something we've talked about in previous weeks, and I just want to highlight it again. Your story, your faith story, is not, one, in a vacuum, and then, two, it has so much power. Because when you do walk through an illness, all right, and so maybe something has happened, you're trucking along in your life, and maybe at said point there is illness or tragedy or what have you, and then you've journeyed on through it. Well, someone who is walking a path that's similar to yours, and when they get to when they are in a season of tragedy or hardship or what have you, and they're here, obviously they want concept theory, theology that helps them give a frame reference, a worldview. But that's the small part. The real powerful part is the one that says, I know what this is like. This is what it was like for me. Now, I've been removed by time-wise, okay, not emotional, just time-wise, by said amount, so I can tell you at least what it was like for me and what has happened since. All right, that's encouraging. And so again, it's not if we will share, it's when we share. And there are so many common elements to us all that people are looking for someone who's made that journey through. You know, I mentioned, I think it was a couple of weeks ago, and I think it's in Buddhism. There's a concept of what they call bodhisattvas. And bodhisattvas are people who, and in part of Buddhism, the goal is to reach enlightenment. And it's those who have reached enlightenment and have an opportunity to journey on into enlightenment. But what they do is they choose not to go, and they go back to help others find their way. All right? Well, I mean, you know, the concept is good. All right? I mean, and that's similar to what this is. I've journeyed through this. I know what it's like to embrace God through all this process. And this is what it's been like for me. And I'm not, you know, I don't want to just leave, you know. One way you could look at it is just say, well, good luck. I had to deal with that a few years ago. And you know, when you get on the other side, you know, I'll be 10 more steps in front of you. All right? You know, I mean, so you could approach it that way. Or you could approach it from the idea that says, you know, part of what I want to do is to help another, one, because I've been commanded, and but two, I you know, hopefully I want to do that. And the way I do that is by sharing what that experience was for me. So it's this method that Jesus is using is very valuable. And so don't just see in the text the theology that Jesus is seeking to teach to the people. See how he's doing it, the methodology as well, because that's of great importance for us, for how we will follow in his footsteps. So I hope you can kind of see this on two different levels. And for them, what's real easy and very common is this idea of shepherds and gate and door. And you know, so when we get to the part, I mean, it was read for us as, I am the good shepherd. Another one of the I am statements. Back in John chapter 6, I am the bread of life. Do you remember back in chapter 6? They were talking about bread. Well, he then says, you know, you're holding this. There's something more than I am, you know, I'm behind that symbol. Shepherds, I'm behind that symbol, that analogy. This is what it's like. And so we can borrow some of that method and use that in helping another, because there are so many things we have more in common. I mean, not just in the other denominations, you have more in common just the fact that we're humans. And so, I mean, if there's another human around, you got more in common with them than we do not in common. And, you know, unfortunately, as a people, I mean, we're good at picking up the differences. And you know, but there's more in common that we have with people, you know, not just our neighbors, just in the fact that they're people. When I was in my first year in seminary, my roommate was from Japan, and his name was Koji. And Koji had been in the United States maybe 3 months when I moved up there to Kentucky. And it's supposed to be a guy from Florida. And for whatever reason, that guy did not go. So I walk into my room, and I was doing a term before Brooke and I were to get married, and then we were going to move up. She was going to move up there with me. And, you know, I'm like, wait a minute. You know, this is not right. And, you know, and of course, there was a language barrier. And but I discovered he likes to eat hamburgers just as much as I did. And he loved Tex-Mex just as much as I did. And on Sunday nights, where he wanted to go more, I mean, I had a car, he did not. And so where he wanted to go was to Don Pablo's. And if you know anything about Lexington, Kentucky, that's one of their big Tex-Mex restaurants. And where they make the flour tortillas right there in front of him. And, you know, Koji, you want to go eat? Mm-hmm. Yeah, where do you want to go? Don Pablo's. You know what I mean? You know, so there we go. His wife was Amy. And he was going to pursue ministry was going to be separated from his wife for 2 years because she could not come over. When we started to learn each other, all the way across the globe, he's about 20 years older than me, language differences, but I know that he loved his wife. I know he loved his family. I know he loved God. I know he liked to eat certain things. It would have been real easy to say, man, this is terrible, because we had about this much different. But when I got the flu and couldn't get out of the bed, he took care of me. And I drank and ate so many Japanese, there's no telling what I was drinking and eating, but it made me feel better, I tell you. And then he called Brooke and in broken English tried to tell her, that I was sick. Don't discount all the stuff that you have. Because it's not just with the people next to you. And we think we're the isolated one. And we think our story is different from everybody else. And so in order to do that, in order to actually share, you do have to be vulnerable, okay? Because you do have to invite somebody into your life. And so there is some level of fear involved with that. But I promise you, what you'll discover is that fear is unfounded. And remember what fear is. Fear is the narrative you tell yourself. And it's seldom is it true. But we create these stories that we think this is going to happen. And you're talking about family and friends and whatnot. That's probably a big source of fear. What happens is that you end up in a vulnerable state, but what we discover is that our presuppositions are not accurate. And they're dictated more from fear than they are from love. What casts out fear? Perfect love. And the way you love is by being vulnerable, correct? So, you can see what's going on here. Jesus is being vulnerable too. You just follow on in the Gospel of John. You can't get any more vulnerable than giving yourself to die. So it's well versed in a method for us. So any comments or questions? I do want us to come back and talk about some other parts in this passage, but I think we need to take a break before. All right. Okay, let's go up. Where here we are. Ooh. Now, if you'll take one of these and pass them out, and then the prayer list. Did somebody pass? Did someone make a copy of the prayer list? I don't even know where it's at. Okay, good. So we're getting it copied. Excellent. Someone who's watching online said something a while ago I thought was pretty good. This would be a help us maybe on the whole concept of when I mentioned Bodhisattva. If you think back to the Great Divorce, you know, the people come down the mountain, so they leave being connected with God. They come down the mountain to meet those to try to bring back up the mountain. So similar concept there. From C.S. Lewis's book. So see how many wonderful things come from C.S. Lewis? So, you know, go back to the problem of pain, you know, it might trigger up some images, right? All right, so let's, we've got just a handful of minutes, 30, before we'll break. Just some things that come out of the text that we need to pay attention to for what makes for a good shepherd. And because Jesus makes this comparison that he is the good shepherd, you have this idea of purpose of concern. You know, good shepherds will labor so that the sheep can have a good life. So in verse 10, you've got this this what we would call a purpose of concern. Jesus is very sheep-centered in how he's acting, not so much with thieves or with robbers who seek to steal, kill, and destroy. And so you see, at least in this compare and contrast between Jesus and thieves and robbers, that Jesus, the Good Shepherd, has a purpose of concern that is sheep-centered compared to the others. At the same time, there's a degree of self-sacrifice for the safety of the flock. The hired hand, look at verse 13, has a lack of concern in times of danger. But the good shepherd is willing to lay down his life for the sheep, verse 15. It's important to note that this idea of a self-sacrificing shepherd for the flock compared to someone who is more me-centered or self-centered and seeks to use the sheep for their own benefit. And then notice that there's a concern for the knowledge of the sheep and them of him. They recognize his voice. You know, he speaks often of that. And so there's a level of recognition between one. I mean, the shepherd knows his sheep. The sheep know his voice. So there's this level of knowledge of each other. Or maybe you could, if you don't like the word knowledge, you can put relationship. Or there's a relational understanding there. And then in verse 16, there's an idea for the shepherd has a passion for unity, one flock, one shepherd. You see that in verse 16. So when Jesus talks about himself being the good shepherd, it's if you look at the passage and sort of unpack those or pick them out and look at them on a larger level, you'll see these connections. There's a concern, it's self-sacrifice, there's a knowledge or relational, and then there's a unifying or this passion for unity, and which would be the evidences of what makes for a good shepherd. And Jesus is saying he is that. So it's a lot going on inside the passage. And then we get in verse 17, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it up from me, or no one takes it from me. I lay it down on my own accord and have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from the Father, or from my Father. Now, I passed out also a sheet that has this little diagram on it. Did everybody get one? Yes. And so part of what we've got going on in the passage is you know, this idea of what eventually will be what the early church calls the Trinity. And you know, what we believe about there are passages in the Bible, like John 10, that make comparisons where you see that they are distinctive of each other, and yet at the same time, they are each other. And so often for us, I'm going to grab one. I probably should have got my computer. And did everybody get one? All right. So I think Sandy was channeling her early bowling years. She's been grieving not being on a bowling team anymore. So she was trying to pick up the spare. if it's any consolation, when I was out at SMU, a guy had just bought this thing of coffee, and we were getting ready to start class, and I borrowed a book, and I went to pass the book back, and I thought, well, I'm just going to kind of just, you know, and I wasn't paying attention, and I passed it, and it hit his coffee and just spilled over into everybody's coffee. And so I was like, yeah, fantastic. You know, so I mean, where can I hide, you know? So hide down, you know? So I mean, I think I'm going to skip that class. So, all right, but what we've got is, and there are other examples. Obviously, the if you look in the synoptics, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you've got when Jesus is baptized, you have where they are distinct, three distinct persons, and then at the same time, they are. So there's a oneness and a threeness at the same time. But sort of holding those in contention so that the threeness is not overemphasized at the extent of the oneness, and then the oneness is not overemphasized at the extent of the threeness, sometimes a picture helps. And so I was just looking through some old stuff and found this picture, and I hope this is helpful when it comes to the Trinity. Some of the first heresies that take place in the church over the first 100 years, maybe around 80-ish A.D. to around 200 A.D., have to deal with this holding this in tension. And there are times where they would overemphasize the oneness, and they would get they would get off into some areas that would be it, then when that plays out, it would play out into some negative applications or practices, behaviors. And then there are times where they would overemphasize the threeness of it. And then, of course, you know, same thing would happen. One of the early ones is a heresy called Marcionism. Now, he was one of the first collectors of the different letters that we have as the New Testament. And he started to collect these letters. And he was predominantly drawn towards the writings of Paul, the letters of Paul. Well, Paul writes extensively about the role of the Spirit. And so for Marcius, he saw the Old Testament as sort of like the era of God the Father. And for him, he said that's a very wrathful God, a very vindictive God, a punishing God. And he said, you know, after that came, and this would be, say, the Gospels, there's the reign of Jesus. And that Jesus, that reign was very short, just a few years. But now we are in, and mainly through Paul's writings, now we are in the era of the dominion of the Holy Spirit, and so what he would say is that the only thing that counts for us is the Spirit. And so he's stressing the threeness of God. God the Father, already happened. God the Son, already happened. And so now the church is living in the era of the Holy Spirit. And so anything that had to do with God the Father, said don't pay attention to it. You know, really, you don't have to pay attention much to, you know, Jesus accomplished what he was supposed to do. And so it's sort of like getting a ticket. The ticket's been used, been punched. You can discard it. What counts now is the role of the Holy Spirit. Well, on one level, that sounds good, right? I mean, we want the Holy Spirit. Paul's writings talk a fair amount about what the Spirit does, what the Spirit does in the life of the church, what the Spirit does in the life of the person. And so there was no oneness, but only threeness. Well, when that started to play out into people's lives, it got really, really ugly. And because what you have is then, you know, Shane would say, I'm operating under the role of the Spirit. All right. And then you would have Sue that would say, I'm operating under the role of the Spirit. And then you would have Carol that would say, I'm operating under the role of the Spirit. You know, and then this person and then that person. And so it created all these cliques. And at the same time, it created all these factions where they would fight against each other. Can you think of a New Testament book where that took place? Absolutely. The book of 1 Corinthians. And I mean, and so what you had is, I'm, you know, I've got this knowledge, I've got that knowledge, I've got this gift, I've got, you know, and so, you know, those that, and then people would just flock to those different types of leaders who would all say, under the auspice of the Holy Spirit, I'm now, you know, I'm the leader. Well, I mean, you know, that's one of the negative ways it could play out when we overstress the threeness at the expense of the oneness. When in the early church, when they would overstress the oneness, they got something called modalism, which comes from a Greek word to model, and they would say that it's just one God who has three hats. For instance, during the time of the Old Testament, this God just put on the hat of the Father. And during the time of the New Testament or the Gospels, this God put on the hat of Jesus. And then now puts on the hat of the Holy Spirit. And that would play out into some crazy activities as well, where they were trying to stress the oneness of it at the expense of the threeness of it. So the holding that theological concept of Trinity, you have to hold it with the three and the one together, but in chapter 10, this is a good example of it, of Jesus, where you see they are distinct, and yet at the same time he's making comparisons of they're all the same. You know, in the Old Testament, I mean, in the New Testament, particularly the Gospels, their biggest struggle was that Jesus, the oneness of it. You know, I mean, why did Jesus get in trouble? I mean, it really wasn't because he healed somebody on the Sabbath. Why did he really get in trouble? Blasphemy. I and God are one, all right? So they didn't have a struggle with the distinctive part, you know, being separate. They had a part of trouble with the unifying part of it. Somebody saying something? Oh, sorry. But anyway, I hope this helps. Sometimes pictures can help us with being able to process. But this is a good chapter where you at least see the beginning of. Or not the beginning, but you just see another example of the three and the one, you know, being together. Well, actually, here it's just the two and the one, because he's not mentioning the Spirit per se in this chapter. He does talk about the Spirit later on when we get to chapter 14. But you at least see some level of three, or, you know, of unique oneness and unique threeness as well. Notice also that is in verse 18, I mean, he is starting to talk about death. And this is one of the first times he actually mentions death, his death, in the Gospel of John, and that it's not forced upon him, but it's something that he actually lays down and then takes it back up. So there is at least the beginning of that his death is not the end of the story. This idea of taking up his life again, the idea that the Father gives him authority, there's that threeness there. And that also is further talked about in Romans and 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, and then the idea of God raising him back up. Now the result of this, what we find in verse 19, is that the house is divided again over the claims of Jesus. Some thinking it's blasphemy, the others, there are others who think that he's doing something. You know, it's interesting. Jesus says things that, from what he says, it's blasphemy. I and the Father are one. And but it's hard to discount what he's doing. And, you know, I'll say this, and John, please edit this later on. We're doing college visits, and right now there's a school in Alabama that's not Auburn that my son is at least leaning towards. And so on the tour, they want you to say certain things that I was not willing to say, and do certain things, and they end it around this stadium. That is not as pretty as Jordan-Hare Stadium. And there are all these statues. And then you walk down this road that's got all these national championships. And so as much as I would like to be very frustrated with this, it is hard to argue with who I see on Saturday, every Saturday on the sidelines. And so there is some proof in the pudding, as much as I don't like the words that come out of their mouths, you know. Kind of like what's going on inside the text. And, you know, it's hard to argue with Jesus when Jesus is healing people. It's hard to argue with Jesus when Jesus is doing things that the other leaders cannot do. And of course, he's saying the reason I can do this is because I am connected. Actually, not just connected to God, I am one with God. So the words, there's a struggle. It violates theological understanding. But the actions also, if you go back in the Old Testament and you look at the things that only God, that are ascribed to God for what God can do, even working through a person, Jesus is able to do all of those and more. And so the house is divided. Which makes the Good Samaritan story so difficult, if you think about it. I mean, what makes the Good Samaritan story such a hard story to really read is because by birth and by geography and you know, anything else you want to look at, there's no way in the world the Good Samaritan should be welcomed or even to be an example of. And yet by his actions, he is living what others should be doing. It's interesting. This idea of, you know, actions compared to teachings or how we might process. And you see it here with the people and how they react to Jesus. By his actions, it's hard to deny what, you know, he go back to John chapter 9. The blind man, all I know is I was blind. And the next day I'm seeing. I didn't even know the guy. They had to tell me who his name was. And, you know, you want to question me about all this? I don't know. I can just tell you I couldn't see one day, and the next day I could. And it happened to be when I met this guy. I don't know who he is. Later on he meets him. I love the interplay with the leaders and the blind man. Where, you know, when they start to quiz him, he actually starts to quiz them. said, how are you to deny the actions? Let's go back then to the idea of evangelism. When you see a life change, skeptical as we might want to be, but there's levels of change that take place, and those persons are equating that change to the influence of God in their life, how do we argue with that? I mean, even if it's not exactly the way we want it to, you know, doesn't play out exactly the way we want it, or maybe it takes longer, or maybe they're going too fast. If their life is changing, I mean, you know, the actions of them speak for themselves. And, you know, which is interesting. And sometimes people come up to me and say, well, what do you think about so-and-so? And a lot of times my response, my first, you know, canned response is, I've got more than the worry with, you know, I mean, I don't need to worry about someone else. And then the other response is, you know, I don't know, I haven't talked to them in the last 5 minutes, but their actions prove X. You know, it might not be exactly, you know, how we would want it, but, you know, the Good Samaritan is just caring for folks. And he does it out of his own sense of self and his own sense of his own resources, and even at his own peril. You know, the safe thing to do was to just keep on going. And yet, by all factors, you know, like I think I told y'all one time, I was running a youth camp, and there was a guy that he'd been a Christian maybe a couple of years at best, and he didn't have it all down with his speech and the way he talked. And I'll never forget, we were praying for the camp, you know, before the camp started, before all the you know, the middle schoolers and some of the high schoolers were going to be there. And so we were just kind of taking turns praying, and he was sort of like a counselor in training. And it got to him, and it's one of those moments I never forget. He said, God, he said, this is my first go at it. And he said, I want so desperately not to screw this up. And that was his prayer. You know, and at first I thought, what? You know, I was like, did he just say that, you know? And we don't say that in our house, you know. And I thought, well, no, he probably got it. He's probably got the most authentic prayer here. And so there's part of me that was like, you know, hey, you can't say that, you know. And, you know, but, I mean, that guy was an all-star. And, I mean, if you asked him to scrub a toilet with a toothbrush, He had no pride in it, and he would do whatever it took to make that experience for those teenagers the best experience. And so, you know, some people might get it wrong on one level, but when you look at the whole scope of their actions and the whole scope of what they're trying to do, that's probably the better judge. And that's something for us just to kind of, you know, it's so easy for us to not suspend judgment and just to allow it, and because our anxieties get into the way. And, you know, being able to sit as a non-anxious presence as best as we can and allow some things to take place out in front of us where we think it might end in a train wreck, and it very well might. But sometimes even the greatest learning experiences still come from trial and error. And so the idea to just, you know, just trust and to give time for the whole scope of the work to prove itself, sometimes that's a really good, it's a hard path to take, but it normally serves us all well, difficult as it is. Right, well, you know, which is actually a parable. I mean, all right, so I mean, you know, one of the parables is a guy owns a field, and the caretaker of the field goes to the owner and says, you know, there are weeds growing with the flowers, and said, I think we should pull out the weeds. And the owner says, well, if you pull out the weeds, you're going to hurt the flowers too, right? And they said, yeah. He said, well, I tell you what, you just wait to the end of the day and harvest them when they're supposed to be harvested, and I'll sort out what's what. And, you know, and again, that's sometimes that's easier said than done. And it's hard for us. I mean, I'll speak first person. We like what's ours, and we like what's easy to dictate and control, and to that makes us feel safe. And to suspend things for, even if it's for a season of time, that's very difficult, because that forces us to alter a different way than what's comfortable. I mean, loving people is difficult. You know, if everybody just would do what I tell them to do, man, we wouldn't have any problems at all. And but to love someone who you know, sometimes says the right things but doesn't do them, someone who says the wrong things but will do the right thing, you know, just being able to sit with that is incredibly difficult. And and yet that's exactly what God does. And so we lose track of that. We lose track of that inside the church, that, you know, receiving grace is suspended judgment. I mean, think about that. I'm going to have to remember that one, so make sure that doesn't get edited. But it is. I mean, you know, it's, and actually what it is that God takes the judgment unto himself the same way that a parent does. I mean, parents are gladly will take it in if it meant that the child or the grandchild or whoever can prosper and grow and whatnot, and which is why the parental analogy and the only same thing with spouses, you know, those two, the marriage analogy and the parental analogy are the two most common analogies to describe God's activity with humanity. But I mean, to love someone, you know, requires a level of, I mean, you actually invite anxiety into your life to love somebody, because you to stay connected and to stay engaged, even when it might not work out exactly how you would want it to be, or even how you would prefer it to be. I mean, that's to suspend certain things. That's to invite sacrifice. That's to invite. It's actually to give power to someone else, to use those terms. And again, it's not unlike what God does. I mean, God gives you the ability to alter creation. I mean, for the betterment of it or for the destruction of it. And your words, perfect example. Actions, perfect examples. I mean, you can say things that actually, people can either get smaller or taller in your presence by just what you say. I mean, you know, case in point, don't tell them you're doing this, or tell them afterwards. Don't do this, but just, you know, talk, the way my grandmother used to say it, talk ugly to someone. And if you're in a place of authority, watch them cower. They'll actually get smaller. And then at the same time, encourage and uplift, and to talk with edifying speech, and you'll watch them get taller. I mean, it's amazing how that works. And so, same thing with your actions. I mean, you have the ability to alter the realities around you, and which is really a gift that God gives us. And you know, we forget that. I forget that all the time. And so, anyways, we're leaving the text, and I've just totally botched it. So for that. We'll stop here, though, and we'll pick it back up. Well, we've got into it a little bit. I mean, we didn't even actually read into verse 22, but we got into the idea of Trinity. So next week, we'll pick back up and probably go quickly through that part, and then maybe jump into chapter 11. Because I hope you've noticed, in the Gospel of John, there are chapters that are teaching, mostly Jesus interacting, and then it's normally that normally comes after some event, teaching to explain the event. Then there's another level of experience or activity. Chapter 11 is called, and then when we get in after that, there's a lot of teaching. So John's gospel has that little bit of a pattern. All right, don't forget, if you are interested in St. Paul for All, the sign-ups are helpful because that just helps us put people in what positions they would like to be in. So just want to remind you of that. It is. It is. Yeah, it's, you know, we just had a lot going on in the last 2 months. And so I just want to remind you again. I mean, most of us think Sunday to Sunday. And so here it is. All right, go in peace. May the Lord be with you.